have quorum. Madam Clerk, are there any changes to the agenda?
No changes.
Any declarations of interest? None are noted. You have before you the minutes of our March 1st meeting and errors or omission. Otherwise, I'll accept the motion moved by Parker, seconded by Pearson to approve the minutes. All's in favor?
Carried.
Opposed? The motion's carried. We have three presentations to for our consideration. So the first one is 4.1 of the AODA compliant website examples. Okay.
Thank you. Just an agenda on the screen. We actually bundled a couple of our presentations on their agenda items into one PowerPoint presentation. So just to review, we're going to do a demonstration of the AODA compliance. We actually have a discussion about a compliant website. We had some challenges finding one that would be a suitable demonstration. But we wanted to demonstrate how the use of assistive technologies and devices enables folks to independently access the city's website. So we're going to review that today. We're going to give you a brief update on the web technology assessment that's currently underway, and also an update on the business case project that's upcoming. At our last meeting, you had asked for a visual presentation of the two projects, the web and the call handling project together. So we have a brief graphic for that, and then an update on the call handling project.
Okay.
And I'll pause at sort of each of those. So in terms of the accessible websites, just to reflect on what we talked about last time, the work that is currently underway for us here, and we've had our heads down, we're working in the departments quite heavily, was three pieces: to identify which websites we can consolidate into the city's main website. So as we've mentioned previously, we have a couple of dozen websites that are external to the city's main website. And in order to simplify the AODA process, we want to look at which ones are ripe for consolidation with the city's main website. So which ones are fairly small in nature and aren't really providing complex services that we can then integrate into the city's main website. And that will make it easier for us to meet our requirements. The other activity we are looking at is looking at all of the information on the city's website and reviewing it all and making sure that it is up to date, that it's providing relevant information, and that it's providing information that citizens are looking for. And where it's not meeting those criteria, we're reviewing the content and trying to simplify it down, trying to reduce content ultimately to make it easier to meet the AODA requirements, but not necessarily reducing information. So we want to make sure that all the important information is still on the site, but that there's fewer pages for us to maintain. And the third piece that we're looking at is all of our online services and systems to review those for AODA compliance. So our website is a collection of many systems, and we need to look at each one of those independently and see whether it is meeting the AODA compliance, and where it's not, have a plan for how we're going to get it there. So that's the work that's currently underway. And again, we're working with all the departmental web agents. And we've done a lot of work with SMT and with the DMTs to get them to understand where their role is in ensuring we meet that AODA compliance. We also have a training that is happening actually tomorrow, with many staff within the city coming forward for that training to get an understanding of AODA compliance so they can have an understanding of how that's going to impact their plans and their website. So a brief discussion about assistive technology. And assistive technology are tools and software that enable people with disabilities to independently access websites and to be able to use those websites. And as we talked about last time, there's sort of some examples where people can get their heads wrapped around. So the font size is a good one, the text size. Folks understand that it's hard to read that small text. But there is quite a bit more to it than that. We just want to keep bringing forward the different experiences that we need to focus on so that we can make sure that we're making our website truly accessible for everyone. So obviously there's impacts to what visitors can see and hear on the website. And that's the text, the images that we use, but also the structure of the pages, so where we use tables or bulleted lists, where we have audio and video, we need to make sure that we have alternatives for each of those. So we're looking at also what visitors can read and understand on the website, and that is about the comprehension level, so making sure that people of all ages and all education levels and cognitive abilities can understand the content on our website. And it's also about how visitors move around the website. So for instance, some people may have limited mobility of their arms and therefore need to use the keyboard, for instance, to move around the website. And that's a totally different experience in terms of using a mouse. Other people may have shaky movements, which may make it challenging to focus in on one area and click on certain links. So how they move around the website, and there's various techniques that you use to make it easier to move through a website. And there's also how visitors interact with our online services and forums. We have quite a few of those on our website. And so making each of those work for people with disabilities and for all people takes a bit of focus and quite a bit of review and modification of how that system works. So it's pretty broad, AODA, but today we are actually going to focus on one particular example, and that is for people with visual disabilities. And we're going to walk through an example. We have a guest here today, Paula Kilburn, from our Advisory Committee for People with Disabilities. And the Advisory Committee has been really helpful in providing feedback to us and helping us understand the different experiences and the different ways we want to think about how our website is used. The example that Paula's going to walk us through today is accessing, the example we've chosen is a Valley Park swimming schedule. And so we're basically going, Paula's already shaking her head. And so this is the example of a schedule that hopefully we'll get to at some point. And it's about all getting to the schedule is a challenge in and of itself. And then once you're at the schedule, interacting with the schedule to get the information you need to be able to then take on the task that you want to take on. So with that, I'll turn it over to Paula, and Paula's going to talk a bit about the assistive technology that she uses and how that impacts her use of the website.
Hi everybody, thank you for having me. JAWS, I use the JAWS screen reader. JAWS stands for Job Access for Windows. Don't ask me why, I have no idea. There's a little shark comes up on the screen for JAWS. It helps me to read documents, web pages, anything else that's on the internet, or any documents like Microsoft Office, calendars, emails. So I can do everything that everybody else can do. I just don't use a mouse. And I don't need a monitor. If there wasn't one on here, I wouldn't need it. But because it reads from top to bottom or from side to side. Wherever you navigate to go, it will read for you, right? It reads everything though, so you have to be able to control it or you will just have verbal overload. So it's easier to show you than to tell you. So. I don't know whether we're connected to that.
Oh, I'll just, if I could control your computer for a second.
You may.
Thank you.
Samantha, we'll talk to you.
0/home/in pure L. E dot enter.
Okay, so we're at Google now. You're connected.
Edit unavailable. Edit, list and, link calendar, link news.
Okay, I slowed it down, so if it's too slow, let me know, because I can make it faster by a lot.
Google.
Okay, so we're gonna go to.
Edit, space, M, escape, control O. /home/tags300x300.
Okay, so
City of Hamilton official website.
So the Valley Park, and demonstrate how you hopefully navigate to that. At some point, we may stop and just actually go to that website, because it might be challenging to get that sort of experience that a lot of demonstrators.
That's crucial.
Yeah.
So what I'm gonna do is I'm going to list all the links on this page.
Internet Explorer window classes dialog, new class edit, Internet Explorer server, escape, City of Hamilton official website of the City of Hamilton Windows Internet Explorer. Jaws dialog, links list dialog, links list view, myhamilton.ca skip to main content, 1 of 56. To move to items, use the arrow keys. T, templates,
whatever.
R, recreation centers,
wow.
Parks, swimming and skating.
Oh, I gotta turn it back down.
So, as everyone uses through a website, you're mainly looking for links as you get to something. And the more links we have on a page, that can sometimes be more challenging.
Enter, recreation centers, parks, swimming and skating, visiting link, City of Hamilton, recreation centers, parks, swimming and skating.
Well, I guess I would know about the park if it's on here. See, the thing with using a screen reader is and not being able to see the screen, you don't know actually what's on that page. So most of the time, it's trial and error. Or I start at the top of the page and I read it line by line until I get to the bottom to find out what's on it. Once you've been on the page, you should get used to where you're going. So you know what links to go to. But this one, I've only been on once and I didn't like it, but we'll try again.
Yeah.
I don't think any of us would want to try.
Links list view, submit search, 18 of 40 fee. Videos to help you understand your city and services, waste fee.
I don't think there is a Valley Park on there, so.
Fee.
So, I don't know where to go now, so.
S, site requirements. S, site map.
Nope.
And you're doing S for swimming?
Yeah.
Is that right?
Did you not put Valley Park in the search?
It came out videos.
You could navigation is sort of the way that someone might try and
get
the site
use.
Oh, sorry.
Yes.
We did the bad thing again.
Site map. Help and FAQs. Use.
Sorry, that's FAQs.
No.
Sorry.
Images/top of page. Sign requirements.
I think it should change.
Private terms of use. More. Learn about the 2000 City of Hamilton holding annual. MyHamilton.ca. Skip to main content.
Okay, so.
So as you can see, the information that Paula needs to be able to get there is not there.
It's really challenging.
She needs to. So maybe, Paula, we can go straight to Valley Park and show the schedule example.
Oh, okay.
I'll take
it.
He's
taking over.
Is Paula able to track
escape
down the left side
recreation
of that thing
centers,
to the rec center's
parks,
indoor pools
swimming
and
skating, heading level one.
So you could go through all the links.
I have to go through all the links.
And so, okay.
Yeah.
And so because the
and
the
I
top
have to know what it
navigation
begins with.
Right.
Yeah.
The top
right
is our navigation, and so each one of those would trigger a link, so they would have to go through 15, 20 links.
Wow.
Just to start with the content there.
That would be
wow
so frustrating.
Rec centers, indoor pools and arenas, visited link, City of Hamilton, out of center, visited link print.
Look at all those ones.
Oh, I know. I get everything.
Yeah.
Well, I would have done the first one.
Oh, I
see.
Yeah. Swimming visiting link. City of Hamilton Recreation Valley Park Arena and Rec Center. Recreation Valley Park Arena and Rec.
So on this page, there's the table with the schedule.
Oh,
so
this could be interesting.
Paula, maybe we
visiting
can go to the header one.
Okay, I can do headers.
Public swimming schedule, April 8th, June 10th, 2013, heading level 2. Summary, this table contains the drop in swimming programs for April 8th, June 10th, 2013. Blank, table with 8 columns and 5 rows. Blank, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, 9:10 p.m.
See, it will give me all the dates, then it will give me all the dates.
Because this table is reading left to right, it's reading the top row, which is Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and then it reads the next row. The place within the table is lost because it's just reading left to right.
Okay.
And so there's techniques and tools you would apply to how you develop tables to in order to, as it's reading through, it can stop and give a placement. So it would say Adult Swim 9 to 10 p.m. on Thursday, so that all of the information is provided in that cell. We don't have that done, and actually we tried to find an example where someone in a municipal context had that done, that a table could read well, and we actually couldn't find any examples. So it demonstrates the challenge, and these tables appear in many places on our site. Well, in fact, quite a lot of our site. Our minutes and agendas, our meetings, all of those things are presented in the table format. And this is just one example of the challenge of experiencing our website. There are many other examples.
So you try and remember, you know, you go, okay, Monday, Tuesday, and then you go by the day, and you have to match them up in the little brain here, and sometimes it doesn't work that way, and then you get frustrated, and I turn it off.
Especially when the times are all different, because I know I've got the schedule, I printed off, it's on my fridge, but the times are all different too, so it's not like it's consistent 6:30 to 8, 6:30 to 8, they change through the week too.
That's right.
Which makes it very confusing.
And if they miss out a day,
right.
I don't know they've missed out a day, right?
Right, you see in this schedule there's blanks.
Yeah, right.
So if you're using counting to keep track of where that
is, it wouldn't work.
You will lose track.
Because it doesn't say blank. So.
Can I ask a question to you, Paul?
Yes.
If you were to, when you print material off, I notice you have Braille there.
Yes.
Can you get it printed, or does somebody have to do that for you?
I have an embosser at home.
Okay.
I can do it myself.
Okay.
But print tables is just as fast, because it'll do exactly the same thing. It'll give me all the days, and then all the dates, and then the information underneath.
Gotcha.
There is a way to do it, but for the average person, they wouldn't. Like, there is a way to read tables, but for the average person that's using this website, I'm sure wouldn't be doing that, right? So, you know, this is the way most people with vision loss would be using this website.
Good
yeah, it is frustrating.
I can imagine. Thank you. Thank you, Paul.
You're welcome.
Is it fixable?
Yes.
Good. Sorry, Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
Is that it? Right. I'm done? Oh,
you're done, unless anyone.
Yeah, does anybody have any?
Excellent. Thank you so much.
Next time, I think you should all have a go at doing it. So. And see how you work it. But you can put a demo version on your computers, and just don't look at the monitor. Otherwise, it's cheating. Because my husband does that.
To your left. Yep. To your left.
My other left.
Nope. Sorry. There you go.
And so it felt a bit clumsy with the demo, but that's exactly the point, is that it's really challenging and clumsy to feel looking through the site.
Yeah, it is very, it's it can be frustrating, as I say. I do go to these websites and I start off okay, and then I don't know where to go, so as I say, I read the whole page, and it takes me, I would say, 5 times as long to do that as it would you guys would allow to see. So, less clutter, more text, and well, tables okay if you can do them right. You can do them in link form, okay, in tab form. Have a text version if you want to put the pretty stuff on, and don't make too many links with the first letter the same, or make them so they are actually consistent. I went to one of your sites yesterday looking for jobs, right? One page is, I would have gone and looked for careers, not jobs. So I know it's jobs, So I did the jobs, and then on another page it was careers and jobs. So the links were different on two different pages, so it has to be consistent. I'll give an example of a really bad web page. AMI, which is the Accessio Media thing. Every one of their links starts with AMI. It says AMI video, AMI audio. So when I'm looking for a link, I have to read them all. Anyway, so you'll start with the same thing.
And it's thank you for that, because it's great to demonstrate that the challenges we have are not just technical. And so there is a whole technical piece to becoming AMPA compliant, but those things that Paul's are mentioning are how we publish our content, how we write our content, what words we use in our linking strategies. And that, so it's a much broader than just a technology issue. It's, it covers quite a bit of how we do our business on the web. So with that, the only last piece we have on the accessibility is at the last meeting, we had questions about counselor websites. So we did contact our contacts at the province to ask a compliance manager where that fits within the scope of ABA compliance. Their explanation to us is that the web counselor websites are not required to be compliant at the same time as the city's website. However, as we know, there's quite a high level of citizen expectation around what should be accessible, and so therefore counselors may choose to pursue the same, adopt the same ABA compliance rules and regulations. Certainly the templates, the standards, and the techniques that we apply to the city, we would look to make those available to many folks in the community, vendors we work with, so they can comply with our same rules. And obviously counselors may choose or elect to use those same templates and guidelines as well. So that was sort of one piece. I'll pause there in case there are any questions.
So will you provide us with, start to develop tools that will assist individual counselors' websites to head towards compliance?
So as we are working with our authors in the city, we'll be developing tools, manuals, guidelines that would assist them so they can follow the rules. The rules are quite complex, and we need to be able to give them the tools so like they can follow them and not necessarily have to know all that detail and technical information. And so those tools we would make available, I think, even to public to some extent, to be able to say, this is how to interact with the city, this is how to collaborate with the city, these are the rules and guidelines that we follow. So certainly counselors would be able to access those as well.
Okay. Judy?
So my question is, with city councilor websites, I pay for my own website and all the work that's on it, so who would pay for that?
So I think, and I can't speak entirely about this because it's a clerk's question, but there is that separation of city services and where that translates into counselor properties. So I believe that they are kept separate and that the costs that are incurred would, I believe, would be assumed by the counselors.
So we would have to pick it up personally for those who do.
That's my understanding.
And I guess my other question is, it says the counselor websites are not required to be compliant at the same time, but when would they be required to be compliant?
That's a good question.
Seeing it at all.
I think there is a requirement. So for the requirement for web accessibility applies to the government of Ontario, of course, public sector organizations and large organizations, which I believe are over 50 employees. I can check on that. I can bring all the definitions. So in terms of the city's website, I believe on the city's website, we provide access to the counselors' information, who are the ward counselors, what your contact information is at, and we would take care of making sure that that's accessible. It's then when you link to your own websites, if you choose to have your own websites, then they become your, and that's the piece that they have told us would not be required by the regulation to be accessible. However, they did also talk about the perception of the public, and suggested that we would make our tools and techniques, as Jay has said, available, and we have done that in the past. We also made sure that our, when we were implementing the customer service standard and other things, we made those, our policies and other things available on the city's website, also to help businesses who had to come after us. They had a delay in terms of their implementation, and any information we make available might help other organizations become accessible. So for the same for the council.
Okay, thank you for that. Appreciate it.
Continue, Jay. Anyone else?
Okay, so just a quick project update for the technology assessment that is currently underway. So we've been working with our vendor IBM, who's doing a review of our current state of technology and the web technology of the city. And they've been undertaking preliminary analysis and developing the options lists that they're going to bring forward to us. There is a focus group session on Monday, April 29th. There's actually two sessions that day. And we have done invitations out to many folks that we think would be interested in that kind of a discussion, looking at inviting folks from Mohawk and McMaster Innovation Park, Open Hamilton, the Chambers, so many folks that might be interested in future opportunities to innovate or collaborate with the city in terms of providing better service to citizens.
Just remind us of the times and the location.
They are 2 to 4 p.m. and 7 to 9 p.m. We wanted to have an afternoon one to hopefully make sure we could connect with folks who are business-oriented folks from Monday to Friday, 9 to 5, as well as some of the opportunity for community members and stakeholders to participate in the evening.
And location?
In the location.
Room 9293, just on the first floor there.
And so far we've received quite a few positive responses about attendees, so we're quite pleased with that.
Good.
And the technology assessment, the report that comes back from the vendor will form a portion of our business case that comes forward to GIC in June. And so that business case, we've brought, of course, the outline to you before, as well as at our last meeting, talked about the advertising and transaction fee components of that. And there are other components that we're working on, the web technology assessment. We're putting some additional detail around opportunities for cost savings or revenue generation, as well as meeting our risk and compliance. Those will be the pieces of that, and providing better service to citizens. And that business case will be coming forward at our next meeting in May to this committee. And then we'll be looking at bringing that forward to GIC in June, as I mentioned. I believe it's June 19th. And just an update on the web team. We are very pleased at our next meeting. We'll be introducing the web content coordinator to you. And that's the temporary position that we brought on board to assist us with the visual look and feel, as well as the content review that we're doing. And as I mentioned, we're developing those plans around revising and rewriting the content of the websites. And just an update on the two of the six projects that we're working on. So we've been working with Transit. We met with their DMT to hear from them what their goals and aspirations are in terms of providing better online service for citizens who are accessing transit information. We learned that as their scope broadens to look at all transportation opportunities, walking, cycling, and bus, that they would like their web to also reflect that direction. So we're looking at how that can be enabled. Their online scheduling system is being updated, and so we are going to be looking at how that new system is working for citizens, and if there's any areas that need improvement, we'll be making those improvements over the following months. And the other area that we've been doing a lot of work at scoping what improvements can be made is the clerks, so the minutes and agendas, the online meeting information, as well as next year will be the election information. So looking at the total thing that the clerks will be looking at over the next year, see where we can be adding the best value for that area of our website as well. And we're getting discussions about the other four areas so that we can bring forward all the scopes in that June meeting. And I believe that is my portion of the agenda. So if there's any questions.
Questions of Jay. So Jane, is it you, Paul Hanley?
No.
Or Jennifer.
Sorry.
Okay, all right.
Just before we get to calling.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And last meeting, as Jay mentioned, committee asked if we could just do a quick overview of the two projects that fall under the mandate of this subcommittee and timelines. So what we've tried to put together here in a visual graphic is the timeline. So we've got April to December of this year, kind of in the middle of the slide there. And I've got a separate standalone page for each member.
Right.
So on the top half of that slide are activities and the work associated with the web redevelopment project and kind of how it runs over the course of this time period. And on the lower half is the call handling project and those phases of work. So basically, we've got a few things that are running multiply across probably about 4 month durations for the web project. We've got a significant body of work that'll be launching after the technology assessment is completed and Noise's case has been received by GIC. We'll have a large body of work related to the platform acquisition, hosting, and development. We've got the content, design, look, and feel that will be getting underway as well. And once we get those RFPs out for work, there is still in the background a significant amount of content rewriting, as Jay mentioned earlier. So with the web team, the overall web pages that the city has, we're working with all the departments to look at rewrites, reductions, removal, streamlining. Part of this body of work will also include a lot of things to improve the navigation, so better layout to help facilitate some of the accessibility challenges we know our current layout presents. And so improvements to that navigation will be built into the redesign. And that pretty much takes us to the new technology build and conversion, which will happen at the latter half of this year. And that will all carry over into the early parts of 2014. But for now, we thought it would be good to kind of draw our minds to what happens between now and the end of this year. And then just shifting gears really briefly, the call handling project phase one. Beth will give you a quick update on that project following this slide here. But really, there's about five phases to that body of work, and that will take us from now till October. And with that, I will give Beth to give you a quick update on the project itself.
Okay. So from the previous slide, you saw all the tasks that you did some that we need to move on. And what we've done in this project is something a little bit different in terms of other ones, is that we had an all players meeting, kickoff meeting on April 12th, and Chris Murray did the opening remarks, and we really thought it was important that this be come from Chris and provide a message to the group. It included members of SMT and the directors of the staff that are on the project team. So we recognize that this really involves a lot of people in the organization and the change needs to be managed appropriately. So Chris was very happy to do that and brought a lot to that meeting. Just a refresher, our objectives on this project are three things. The first one is to improve customer service, including call quality and consistency in a managed call environment, keeping in mind the other service channels like the web and those relationships. Our main mission here and second objective is to create a detailed design and implementation plan for a rationalization of these calls based on the 2010 work that was done. And the third objective is to achieve efficiencies that we can potentially reinvest within the organization and in the other service channels, or potentially in budget reductions. So those are our three main objectives there. We have a project team that's established, and this is the project team are those that are managing the call queues that are included in this project, and the kickoff meetings have been held, and they're working hard at the number one task, which is a third bullet there, of developing some assessment criteria that will be used to determine how call queues will be moved into a centralized environment. We want to set the ground rules up front in terms of this, and this will be approved by SMT so that everyone knows how the calls would be assessed. This assessment criteria will be really excellent as well for calls that are determined to move into the call center to develop implementation plans and figure out what the best timing would be to move a queue, what kind of implementation considerations need to be addressed to make sure it's successful. Always keeping in mind the number one mission here is to improve customer service, so we don't want anything to fall through the cracks as we move forward. So the next key piece is really...
So Beth, could you share when you start to narrow down the criteria, could you share it with the members of the committee for us just to take a look at? There might be some gapping from our perspective that's missing that we could comment earlier rather than later in the process. And there may be validity to it or not, but allows us to comment that much earlier.
Yes, and I do want to say that the project team is developing the criteria. So it's I was at a part of the meeting yesterday. It's good that we really want to involve all the areas as well. So we have a lot of eyes on it too. So it would be helpful that you see what's being utilized as well.
Thank you.
And we can do that at the next meeting. It should be ready shortly, so that won't be a problem.
Thank you.
And we can go through some of the explanation, but the criteria isn't a yes and no necessarily. It helps to assess and evaluate the data, and the plan is then to use that criteria with the team to understand what that means in those various environments. A key piece is updating and validating the data. So the approach being taken this time is meeting with each of the call queue areas to make sure that we have full input from the areas and really understanding what's happening in the business, what's happening in with anything such as off phone work, like counter work, if there's someone is doing multiple activities. So that is a key component of working with the groups, and there's individual meetings set up with all of the groups to do that. So really intense schedule with, I think there's 18 call queues that between Verna, Jen, and the consultant will be having all those meetings. So standard approach is being used there. And all of this, then application of the assessment criteria and evaluation of the data that's collected then forms into recommendations. And that will be going to SMT along with implementation principles, and then coming back, the team will then be helping out to develop an implementation plan that works with all of the areas, and then we would be back here in early summer with that plan. The idea being that we want to leave enough time for the report writing and development work so that we can get to the October 2nd GIC as our target date to have something back, and I want to have something that's usable for the 2014 budget process, assuming that there's some opportunities there that we can move forward on. So that gives an overview of where we're at. Verna's today is meeting with the call quality group, which is a side project that came out of the service delivery review, and that group has been absolutely amazing of developing a consistent call quality standard that can be used on every phone in the city. So that group is working on an implementation plan, and with the blessing of SMT, it was really exciting to see that there was unanimous support from all the areas that when you pick up the phone in the city, it would be answered in the same way, and helping them to the areas, all staff really, to develop and improve quality service when you answer the phone. So it has been a really exciting process. So Verna is the project lead, and Jennifer is the project manager. So we set up similar structures to the web project, and then that reports through to the service delivery strategy team, and then we give her regular updates to SMT as well.
And us.
Yes.
Thank you. Okay. Questions to Beth? Any add-ons to Beth? Okay. The next one is, I believe, is social media. Michael?
So I'm just going to kick it off through the chair. Thanks for the opportunity to be here today. Anne's going to set up. I'm going to introduce Anne and the rest of the communication staff that are here today. Anne Lemains is our resident, or one of our resident social media experts, so she's going to be taking through the presentation today. Kelly Anderson is here from Public Works, and we've got Tyler Brown, who's one of our Mohawk College students. He's just shadowing for a few weeks, so I thought it was a good opportunity to come here and see how subcommittees work and see how council and staff work together, and this aligns with communications, which is his background. A few months ago, the subcommittee directed us to come back to the social media strategy. Since that time, we've been working as a communications team in terms of trying to design, develop, and determine what are the appropriate tools that we should be on. We've had some external expertise come in and present both to SMT and have various discussions with us. We had Dr. Alex Sevigny from McMaster University come in. So today, I think what we're looking for really is your feedback in terms of what we're presenting and what Anne's going to take you through, as well as probably some direction in terms of what you'll see in here and some of the next steps. The biggest next step that's in here that we need some direction on and that we'll go back to SMT on is really around resourcing. We've looked at resourcing internally. We've looked at the various options. We'll be going to SMT in the next couple of weeks, having further discussions on the appropriate method. We think resourcing is something that's important. Social media isn't something that we can just kind of do and can kind of half get involved in. It's something that's important. It's something that we've identified as being very important. I think the subcommittee's identified as being very important. So for us, the next step is really to go back to SMT, and there's a number of options internally that we'll be looking at in terms of how to address it appropriately. And I think Chris wanted me to be very clear that we're not looking for new resources of any sort. It's really around how internally we're going to find the resources to look at.
Yeah, we're looking to do it now.
So I'm going to kick it over to Anne, and she'll kind of take you through it.
Thanks, Mike, and thanks so much for this opportunity. I've been really looking forward to presenting this information for a while. So this strategy is really the culmination of work that myself and my communications colleagues across the city we've undertaken. It's really an overview. There's a strategy document that we put together that really goes into a lot more depth. This is really just to provide you with an overview of the direction that we want to take. And we're really looking for your feedback and direction as to how to best move forward. And as Mike mentioned, we are also planning to take this to SMT to get some further input and feedback from them. And I also want to make this sort of an open dialogue, so if there's any questions or if you need to stop me at any time, please feel free. So I just wanted to start by looking at, you know, sort of how we've been responsive to citizens traditionally. We use a lot of different types of communications, from media relations, so things like press releases and things like that. Print, so we use a lot of brochures, posters, broadcasts, so TV and radio, person to person, whether it's at the front desk of a rec center or through our customer contact center, and also online through the web. We're really pushing a lot of information through the web. And I think what the public are coming to expect now is that we move into a new realm and that we start to engage more further on social media. And I want to make it clear that these traditional methods are still going to be important. They're still going to be methods that we're going to continue to use. And we're really looking at sort of building on and adding on the way that we reach out to citizens through social media. So we're looking to really create a balanced approach. And oh, I don't know why it's looking a little weird. But I wanted to take a moment just to look at, provide sort of a broad overview of the lay of the land of social media in Hamilton. So we're a very connected city, and a lot of the online trends that we see happening globally, I think that we're also seeing right here in the city as far as increased internet usage, the rise of social media tools, changing demographics, and I think it's safe to say that many Hamiltonians do use social media. So I wanted to just provide a quick snapshot of what's kind of happening in the city right now, because I thought that this would be helpful to provide some context. Some of you might be familiar with the Hamont hashtag, which is kind of like the online water cooler in Hamilton. And I have to give credit to Joey, who's with us today. He coined this or created this hashtag in, I think it was May 2010, as a way to kind of make it easier for Hamiltonians to follow topics of local interest. The Hamilton community, or the Hamont community, is a very diverse, highly engaged community. They like to stay connected to what's happening in Hamilton. They exchange ideas, share opinions, link to news, ask questions. So on any given day, there's a whole bunch of stuff going on there. As far as the city of Hamilton's presence on Twitter, it really happens departmentally right now. We don't really have a corporate account, which is what we're really trying to go towards. We do have departmental accounts, so I will cite the Tours of Hamilton and Hamilton Economic Development. I think they've done an amazing job of really reaching out to citizens and promoting our city for economic investment and whatnot and tourism. We also have, I think at last count, 9 members of council who are on Twitter as well, which is great to see. And more recently, just going back to those departmental accounts, I think one of the useful ways that we have been using them is through severe weather communications. So in the absence of a corporate account, for example, we had a couple of snowstorms. We've been leveraging those existing departmental accounts and getting them on board to kind of help us out while we were kind of working towards a corporate strategy. So that's kind of where we're at with Twitter. Facebook, that's another place where I looked just to kind of see what was going on. There are several Hamilton-focused pages and groups that exist that were created by Hamiltonians, but these are not City of Hamilton-owned accounts. So when I was just doing a little bit of research, I noticed that there was one group called Hamilton, Ontario. There's 5,700 members on there, and there are 2 pages. One for the City of Hamilton and another one called Hamilton, Ontario. So again, I want to emphasize these are not City of Hamilton accounts. They're not official accounts. There were citizens who took it upon themselves to just create these accounts themselves. And from what I can tell, most of the content, they're sort of one-off postings, advertising events, posting pictures. I don't notice a whole lot of commenting going on. It's really just kind of one-off postings that are going on. And I also want to mention that there are a lot of Twitter users in Hamilton that also have Facebook profiles. So what you'll see is discussions going on Twitter that will be extended onto Facebook, and Facebook gives you an opportunity to kind of extend a discussion, to kind of go into a little bit more detail. So you do see a lot of users that kind of extend discussions on both sites. And these discussions themselves, they can range from kind of spirited debate and thoughtful commentary. Sometimes it kind of goes downhill a bit to venting and gravitating toward the negative. And like Twitter, the City of Hamilton, as far as what we have, there are several departments that have initiated their own Facebook presence. For example, against Hamilton Economic Development, I believe that they have, at last count, they have 381 likes. And I know that Public Health, they use Facebook quite a bit for health promotion campaigns. So again, I want to give credit to the departments out there that have really jumped on board and used social media in that way. And that kind of takes us to where we are now. Sorry?
Go ahead, Jim.
Yeah, I just wanted to add to that EMS and fire are certainly on Twitter, mm-hmm. and their information and police,
yes.
very useful. They're continually posting, and it's relevant, good contextual information that provides links, so you can just go to them. So I think even though that's not a direct City of Hamilton, mm-hmm. but it's important to know that they're on there as well,
yes.
and quite often covering retweeting. The good thing about Twitter is that if there is something there that's of good content, you can retweet it to all of your connections, which I'm sure in our case as counselors, we have residents who are on Twitter who, they receive that information, then they retweet it. And so it does tend to filter out into our respective wards.
Yeah, and that's what's great about Twitter is just that sharing and spreading of information. So that's a great point.
And Tourism Hamilton.
And Tourism Hamilton.
Absolutely.
Yep, they've done an amazing job. They've got an app now, I think. We just released an app for Google. So they're really well ahead of the game. And so it's really a matter of corporately just kind of bringing us all up to speed at the same level. So that kind of takes us to where we are now. I want to sort of take a look at how did we sort of get to this point. And in 2012, we had our media relations policy, which was updated and approved. And in that policy, we really officially recognized, I think, social media for the first time. So we reaffirmed our commitment to maintaining professional relationships with media. So we don't want to get away from that. But it also recognized Web 2.0, which are tools that allow users to interact with each other and access information. So that was really the first opportunity for us to really acknowledge social media for the first time. And the updated policy, it includes a section that addresses social media use. And its main purpose is to really provide staff with guidelines for participating in online communities. That's both for approved business and for personal purposes. It serves to protect the reputation of the City of Hamilton, to limit the liability of employees and the corporation, to manage brand integrity and identity, and to support and adhere to corporate policies and legislated acts, like our technology acceptability policy. So that's kind of a snapshot of what that updated section or what our updated policy was meant to achieve. So all in all, we really wanted to let staff know about the guidelines. And when I talk about sort of when we're promoting our social media strategy, I think an important part of that is going to be internal communication and really reiterating and emphasizing the social media use within the organization. So research and exploration. So I wanted to, since we approved the new policy, one of the things in the policy that acknowledges that we need to create a broader strategy. At the time, we just wanted to acknowledge that social media was here. But then we decided as the SCT, which is the Strategic Communications Team, we embarked on a sort of a deeper examination of the use of social media for citizen engagement. And this is just a list of some of the things that we undertook ourselves. We wanted to really look at what other municipalities are doing to kind of look for best practices to see what's out there. Conferences and events. I had a great opportunity to go last November to Social Media for Government Communications, and it was a really wonderful opportunity to connect with other communicators, not just at the municipal level, but at provincial and federal, so it was a really awesome opportunity. Locally, we have the IABC as well, which is an international association for business communicators. They put on events all the time, and just last week they had a great event on social media. Books, journals, and online publications. In fact, I wanted to bring this one here. I don't know if you've heard of it, but it's Social Media for Municipalities and Municipal Politicians. Municipal Politicians. So this is a great book. I definitely recommend it. Discussion, so as a team, we've been meeting and having discussions on social media. We had an off-site event where we really delved into this topic. And we also undertook some internal and external consultation. I know that Mike did a lot of work in that area, sort of reaching out to stakeholders in the community and folks in the community who really have an interest in this area and are aware of the work that we're trying to do. I also did a little bit of a SWOT analysis, so this is looking at really wanting to make this evidence-based and research-based. We didn't just want to throw a strategy together, but we wanted to do something where we look at the internal and external factors that will contribute to our success or failure. So that's just a quick overview of the work that we did sort of behind the scenes leading up to where we are now. And I want to just quickly talk about what other governments are doing, what other municipalities are doing, just very quickly. And I think it's safe to say that many are still starting out on their journey. We're not alone in this. There's a lot of municipalities out there that are really trying to get up to speed. But I will mention a couple of cities, Waterloo, Edmonton, and Calgary. If you ever get a chance to go on their website or follow them on Twitter, they've really well advanced in terms of using social media, including Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, RSS feeds. And I put a couple of screenshots up here. So this is the City of Waterloo's homepage. So you'll see in the upper right-hand corner, they actually put right on the homepage, you know, links to their social media, how you can connect with them. And I love City of Calgary, which is, they're like rock stars in my view. So if you look in the upper right under their logo, they have buttons to all their social media sites. And there's also a page that they have where they posted a video. It's just a quick 1 minute video that tells residents how they can connect with the City of Calgary through social media. So they've done a really great job, and I just wanted to reference those two just to show you what's possible, I guess. And I want to mention that our strategy document, I provide a lot more links and examples of what other municipalities are doing. But I think if I was to summarize, I think a lot of municipalities, they have one corporate account. So example, they'll have one Facebook or one Twitter account through which all city information is communicated. That seems to be what a lot of municipalities are doing. And most municipalities communicate as social media is communications led and communications managed, so you have people in those roles managing that function. And with social media adoption, the consensus is that it takes a long-term committed effort. It's not something, as Mike was saying before, that you sort of do from the side of your desk. It really takes a committed effort to make it successful. So we just need to decide what model approach will work best for us. So sort of delving further into our strategy, we wanted to take a look at some goals and sort of taking everything into consideration and all the research that we've come across. And this is just a couple of goals that we wanted to achieve. So we want a social media strategy that will support the general public's expectation for enhanced access to city staff and online information. We want to improve the city's ability to effectively get information to its stakeholders, including diverse audiences, through a more balanced, cost-effective approach and use of existing resources. We want to enhance the city's ability to listen to citizens and to other stakeholders, and to, I think, which is most important, is to really learn from their insights and to improve. I think if we want to really be able to tap into what citizens want to tell us and to be able to improve and change our processes. We want to provide more accessible customer service, so we've talked about accessibility today. And that includes responding to questions, requests, and also responding to inaccurate information online in real time. So a lot of times online you have a lot of inaccurate stuff kind of flying around, so I think that social media provides that venue for us to really clarify and get correct messages out there. We also want to make sure that our strategy supports a number of other existing strategies and projects, so that includes our citizen engagement plan, web redevelopment strategy that's underway. So we don't want this to be kind of a standalone thing. It should integrate with the other strategies that we have. And we want to ensure the continuous monitoring, tracking, evaluation of online tools, trends, and best practices. So these were just some overarching goals that we kind of went into. And so we really get into the meat and potatoes here of where we want to start. And I think the strategy would recommend a manageable, controlled, phased approach. We don't want to go out on 50 tools right away, because I think that would just create an uncontrollable situation. So what we're looking to do is to establish a corporate presence through a single Twitter account, which would be the city at City of Hamilton. And this is an account that we already have locked in. This is something that we can activate as soon as we're ready. So again, spreading messages over multiple tools is not recommended at this time. And starting with a single tool, it ensures a reasonable balance of resources. And it provides an easy way for us to really assess a single tool before we start branching out. And we'll also consider incorporating other tools like Facebook, like whatever might work for us, into our citizen and employee engagement work. And we're going to do a one-year sort of reporting sometime in 2014, just kind of see how things are going. And I also want to make it clear that the official accounts that departments are using, they provide a wealth of great information, and there's no intention here to suspend or discontinue those accounts. We want to encourage them to continue doing what they're doing. And if anything, we want to promote cross-promotion, and we want to maybe, you know, for example, we have YouTube videos, that we've done these amazing YouTube videos inside the City of Hamilton. We would love to be able to start promoting those a little bit more. So we're not going to be suspending any existing accounts. That's kind of where we want to go.
So all the existings and the new will be governed by the social media policy.
That's
so
correct.
In other words, as long as they're in compliance, they're free to move ahead and be innovative and inform and whatever, as long as it's in compliance.
Yep, absolutely.
Chad?
So obviously with social media, there's a great amount of interaction. And will it then be one person or a group of individuals then that are going to respond? Obviously, you know, if it's one person, that person is not expected to work, you know, 24/7, 7 days a week. So I'm assuming it'll be a team of individuals that'll have access to the account.
Yes, there's a couple of options that I'll go into as far as resourcing is concerned, and
perfect.
Michael will be able to speak to that further in the next section.
Thank you.
I also want to mention that as much as we have these official accounts, what we also want to avoid are sort of these proliferation of accounts kind of popping up across the city, and our social media policy does speak to that. So it does state that unless employees have specific written approval from their department's communications officer, they cannot participate in social media on behalf of the city. So again, as part of our rolling out, we want to make sure that message is clear to staff. And that will be definitely an important component. So here's where we get into the resourcing bit. So right now, this is obviously an area of understandable concern. Whenever we take on a new initiative, it's always a question of who's going to manage it. And I want to go back to the research and say that many organizations face the same challenge, so we're really not alone in this. In many cities, there are dedicated resources who do take this work on from a centralized communication office. At the City of Hamilton, we don't have that structure. We have a very decentralized structure in place, which makes it a bit of a challenge. So once approval is given for this overarching strategy, It's recommended that staff work with the senior management team to identify options to resource this initiative. And there's a couple of ways that we can do this. So we can look at identifying an ongoing internal resource whose role can be transitioned to include social media, or we can look at a creation of a team of individuals who will oversee the day-to-day management of social media on behalf of the municipality. And I just wanted to quickly show a quick graphic. This is from some research that I came across just recently. Actually, it's in this structuring the social media team. It was a survey that there's an organization called Reagan. They're sort of the online trade publication for communications. And they looked at, asked about, I think it was 2,700 communication professionals across corporate, agency, government, not-for-profit. And they wanted to just take a look at what kind of structure they had in place. And the majority are engaged in social media. Most of them, the tasks are assigned on top of their current job. It's a lot of communications. It's just part of the role. It's part of what you do, and it's an expansion of what you do. And there's another statistic I wanted to mention. Oh, and for those who do social media exclusively, 83% work on teams of three or fewer. So we're not talking huge teams. We're really talking about very tight teams that control what's happening. So I just thought that would be helpful for you to kind of see what some of the research is saying. And as far as researching, further to resourcing, and I don't know, Mike, feel free to jump in at any time. We obviously, while we're going to go back to SMT and explore what our options are, we obviously have an immediate need to re-engage with citizens as soon as possible. So that said, the Twitter account is going to be managed in the meantime by select members of the strategic communications team who are already familiar with social media. And some of the responsibilities will include establishing and maintaining a consistent voice for the city. So we want to make sure that there is consistency there. Content creation is going to be huge. So we know that there's an endless supply of information and news coming out of the city. And some examples of content that we might want to consider include information on city programs, services, initiatives, holiday closure information, city-sponsored events, election information. So I think next year it would be great to have our corporate account to let people know about where to vote, board profiles, council and committee agendas, links to live broadcasts, weather-related information, emergency information. I think this is a big one. I think that it's going to be very important to have that channel. And where it's appropriate, again, we'll retweet information from other city accounts, like from Economic Development, if it's of use. Excluded content, so what we don't want to get into are things like talking about city business discussed between users and the Hammock community. We don't want to delve into controversial issues or business that may or may not involve the city. Replying to certain individuals who are, there's certain individuals out there that are like to take things downhill into negative territory. Non-city sponsored events and promoting individual candidates during elections. I don't think that's something that we want to get into either. So that's just a quick snapshot of that. Another responsibility would be reviewing replies and determining an appropriate follow-up. And we created actually a response flow to kind of help guide us. This is, because we can't just push out information. We can expect that there is going to be interaction, and we want to have a process in place for responding. And I'll show that to you very quickly, very next. And I'll obviously adhering to the corporate social media policy and compiling data for evaluation. Mike, do you have anything to add around resourcing?
I think through the chair to Councillor Collins, and I think Councillor Collins hit on it, and Anne was probably about to mention it. It is about kind of having that consistent voice. So I think where Councillor Collins was going, we have identified probably one or two and maybe up to three individuals within the team that both have a desire to want to do social media and also an understanding and a knowledge in terms of how to do it. And so to maintain that consistent voice, to maintain that ability to have that same type of dialogue that we want out there. That's probably the approach that we're recommending. Again, it's just a matter of how we assess those individuals' times and get them, together on the team so that we figure out how to best resource them.
Okay, Councillor Collins and Councillor Pearson.
Thanks for that. And I thought I heard that it was June. We're going live in June.
I mean, I think we're thinking of sometime in Q2, or maybe over the summer if we transition and maybe a soft launch. I mean, I don't think the Q2 is probably set in stone. I think we're looking to launch it soon. We're thinking the summer's probably the appropriate time through the chair of the council to kind of launch that. So I mean, it isn't set that it's June, but I think we're looking to probably launch once we have some discussions with SMT and kind of hammer out the resourcing. That'll be the time that we're looking at launch.
That's great. And I think last year when I raised this, my vision was to get to the, whether it's the Waterloo's, the Calgary. So yep. we're interacting with people through all of the social media mediums. And so I, when do we expect, I thought I heard you say through the presentation, and maybe you said that we're going to go through maybe a year, find out how we fared with Twitter, and then maybe on to the next, whether it's Facebook or
yes,
through
your chair. Yes, I think the intention is to start with a single tool and really get a good handle on how effective it is and really gauge our interaction with the Hamilton, with Hamiltonians, and then from there we'll look at adding on further tools as appropriate. So.
Great. That's good, sir.
So through the chair, just to add to that, I mean, currently we're on YouTube. YouTube is probably less cumbersome and less time consuming. So I think, as Anne highlighted, we'll probably try to use the YouTube channel. We'll probably try to promote that. There's a lot of videos that we're currently doing for YouTube. So it is another medium. I mean, it's not Facebook per se, and Facebook is something that we've been discussing extensively with the web team and with Jay in terms of the appropriate types of dialogue that we want to have. So I think, you know, as Anne highlighted, we're probably going to head in that direction. Start with Twitter, use YouTube a lot more, at least try to promote YouTube and those videos and the interactivity, and then probably proceed to Facebook later in the year and into early next year.
Sounds good.
Okay.
Thank you.
Councilor Christian.
Yes, just to, like you said, just a few people would be the initial ones to oversee the context of what goes on.
Right.
So will we have a grid of where you're going to get that information from so we know that it's consistent, it's correct information all times, be it emergencies or storm events, anything like that?
Yeah, exactly. So through the chair to the councilor, I mean, that's our objective. You know, probably 2 to 3 people who would always kind of be in contact with one another, but who have, you know, probably the communications background as well as the social media background. We think those two together are important so that the right information is being communicated, the accurate information is being communicated. And it's being communicated, I think, as Jay has, you know, highlighted through a number of these presentations, consistently through multiple channels.
So you're going to have a contact, say, in Public Works, that you know you'll get the correct information being whoever.
Okay. And that'll be, again, through the chair of the council. That'll be through the communications team.
Perfect.
You know, we're trying to use that communications team kind of approach.
Right.
So that the information is accurate and consistent.
Good. Thank you.
Councilor Partridge.
Yes, thank you. And through you, Chair. So I'm really encouraged by what I'm hearing with the correct information coming out from a core group of people. That allows us as councillors to then retweet that information, having some comfort knowing that it has been vetted and it is accurate, and it is something that we can then share with our broader constituency. Can you speak to me, though, just a little bit about crisis management? Because Twitter is obviously great. I'm heavily on it, as are many of us. What this city, I think, needs to do a little better around is crisis management. So when something does blow up, when there is something that really needs attention, if you're on Twitter, then you need to be able to respond and respond quickly. Not just on Twitter, but I think in the broader sense, you know, whether it's media releases going out, we don't see a lot of those going out. I have spoken to you before, but I'd like to see more to get more accurate information out to the whether it's the traditional news media or just, you know, how we get that information out to people. So can you talk to me just a bit about your plans for that?
Through the chair to the councillor, I totally agree with everything you've said, and I think Anne highlighted that at the beginning, one of the challenges we face that's a decentralized kind of communications team has been that ability to interact with one another and to kind of address crises. I think we're definitely moving in that direction. I think the social media strategy is one that, you know, is a good example of us working together to kind of address that. In terms of crises, well, we're definitely going to use all channels. I mean, right now you're right, a lot of the channels that we're using are maybe some more of the traditional channels, but with a lot of the information being shared online, being shared through social media, and some of our crises breaking or exploding on social media, we need to be on social media to be able to react to those in an appropriate way. So I think this strategy and I think this approach will address it from that perspective. We're working with Jay. We've identified some stuff on the web in terms of having our media releases there. There's some traditional things that we've talked about that belong on websites and that we should be sending out that maybe aren't the most frequented of sites on web, locations on websites, but that need to be there from the perspective of if there is a crisis, if there is something that people need to go to. And while it may be a small population of the community, like the media, that go to those sites, the information needs to be up there, it needs to be up there quickly, and it needs to be up there accurately. You're right, you and I've had those conversations. I'm totally aware. I think we need to do a better job. I think social media is probably a great step forward in terms of being able to get some of that information out there in a very quick manner and to clarify any of those misconceptions that are out there.
Yeah, and thank you for that. It's also about managing expectations. And so if within the community, if we are, when we go out and we're on Twitter, I think we need to also be prepared at that time to do the crisis management, because it is going to happen. The expectation from people is that if we are on Twitter, then we, if something does happen, we will be able to respond. And I think that responsiveness is extremely important going forward for us as a city to be able to have a defined plan around that and how we're going to manage it. So I would really encourage you to make that priority as part of this whole process. Thank you.
Good chair to the council. One other thing that I haven't mentioned, and Jane looked over at me, and so they include me. I have had meetings with Jane and her team, because there are some things. I mean, her team's on 24/7 for a lot of the emergencies. And when I say emergencies, not necessarily the crises that break from an issue perspective, but the crises that break from weather-related issues or issues if there's an accident, a fire. I mean, a number of other things that her staff often get called at. So we have started having some conversations in terms of how we utilize the expertise that she's got on her team from a 24/7 perspective. And you're right, managing expectations is the next slide. From a communications perspective, we're going to try to manage expectations in terms of the information we're going to be sending out and how quickly we will be responding. But I think there's an opportunity for Jane's team in terms of customer service. And we have had a couple of meetings. We're going to have a few more. How to use her staff to kind of direct some of those inquiries or some of those emergent issues that come in through other channels and using social media from that perspective. So.
Thank you, Mike. Appreciate it.
Mike and I, as he said, we've met and we've talked with staff because we do have staff on. We're looking at a plan where they would monitor but not reply in the after hours, so that someone is at least looking at what might come up, and then we're still working out the details, I think, of a plan of how we would call either through our on-call supervisors when we feel that whatever threshold is reached where someone maybe needs to be available or not. So we're still working out the details with the communications team and that, but I have started that planning process.
Thank you. That's excellent. Appreciate it.
Chair, Chairman. Well, so two things. Mike, there is an emergency measures protocol for the city. I mean, the committee is chaired by the mayor and the city manager, so there's a detailed protocol. Perhaps the element of the communications element of that protocol needs to be reviewed in view of the new information that Anne's providing us to hear. The other thing is the linkages. You know, a street light's out or power is off, the city gets the call. Horizon seldom gets the telephone call. So one of the things we need to look at is the appropriate parallel linkages on those particular things.
To the councillor, on the emergency issue, we have had conversations with Chief Simons and our two emergency planners. As we're going to the IMS model, we're updating our communication section within that. We had a good meeting with them probably a few weeks back on using social media, using Twitter specifically. There's a lot of information that they want to get out, and they want to get it out real time, especially if we start evacuating people, if there's flooding. Most people have these type of mobile devices. A lot of them are on social media, so we've definitely started to incorporate it into there, and we'll be moving in that direction. And you're right, the linkages is something that I think we're going to work on. I know Horizon is on social media now, but it is about some of that horizontal communication.
I mean, just looking at Councillor Collins' challenges with the Red Hill, when we get the, the catastrophic climate changes and things like that. I mean, we got to block off roads. So in other words, there's detours and things such as that. So I mean, there's a triggering component that goes along with every one of them, and getting the word out is, you know, forget about going across, you know, well, I'm talking about the final revolution, but you know, you can't go across Lawrence Road because it's being topped over by water coming down the Red Hill Creek, whatever the case is, and things like that. It's the detour components and the safety components in that are so very, very important.
On things like that, we do continue to work with the police. They've done a very good job of both managing expectations and I think urging people when it is serious to call 911. And then where it's appropriate, I think Ann's got a flow chart we'll kind of go through that we've worked on and we've looked at other municipalities in terms of how, you know, what's appropriate for social media, what's appropriate for other mediums.
Okay. I'll take it back. Anything further? Ann, continue.
Great. And I also want to mention just on emergency management that we do have a section in our appendix of our strategy that does speak to social media and emergency management. So we have definitely taken that into consideration. And that kind of leads us into managing expectations. We want to make sure that with the public we are managing expectations with them. And the bio section of, in the Twitter page, there's sort of a bio section at the top. And you can also communicate this through our website with the post link to Twitter. That it is the official City of Hamilton Twitter account. We're going to look at sort of hours that we will monitor the account. So it could be, say for example, 8:30 to 4:30. It's not going to be a 24/7 thing right away, except during an emergency. So again, getting back to, we want to make sure that we're being responsive, and certainly I think the public would expect that on Twitter we would be issuing possibly life-saving information at all, you know, around the clock if we need to. As far as response, whoever is assigned to manage the Twitter feed, they'll make every effort to respond to inquiries if an answer is easily available. So I think a lot of what we want to do is try to link to information to the website that's already on there. So if the resident is asking about what garbage day they have, we have a, you know, a link to waste management and that sort of thing. So whatever there is a link available, we'll provide that. Otherwise, if it's a little bit more of a complex question, we'll work with the customer contact center. We have askcityofhamilton.ca and our 546 city, or we want to redirect that citizen to as well. And again, we'll monitor what's going on online. So if there are, you know, maybe 15 people asking the same question, we'll try to make sure we get on that as soon as possible. I also want to address the media. So I'm seeing a lot more and more media reaching out directly to a counselor, or you know, they're asking a question and looking for a response, and we don't know if that's just a way for them to kind of, you know, we want to ask this online, so we want to see how you're going to respond. But I think for the purposes of our Twitter account and for the city, it'd be best to kind of direct those conversations offline and to have those questions handled appropriately by a communication staff person. So we don't want to get into answering questions of media and possibly things coming up. So I think it's important to point that out as well. And this is just a quick response flowchart that we came up with. So this is really going to help to guide us as responses and things come in. We're going to get a lot of questions. Again, we're not looking to use this as just a way to push out information. And rightfully so. Citizens, there's going to be a lot of interest from citizens. They're going to want to ask us questions. So this was just a sort of a draft, a way that we would approach responding. So we would consider the question itself, we would evaluate the nature of the question, the tone, is it something that's really political in nature, is it a joke, is it a rant, and then we have an associated process to deal with those kinds of questions. So this is really just to give you an overview and to let you know that we do have a process in place to deal with any different kind of question. As far as promoting our social media presence, so right now, a long time ago we had this Ham on Palms Twitter feed, and I think there's about 2,500 that are still on there. So one of the first things that I think we need to do is to try to migrate as many of those people over to the new City of Hamilton Twitter account. Try to get as many of them over as possible. We can also expect that there's going to be a strong public appetite for information coming directly from the city. So I think upon launch, we can expect that there's going to be a large following. Word will spread organically among the Hamilton community, and we're not just going to wait for them to come to us. I think it would be good for us to be proactive and to reach out to them, use the hashtag, encourage retweets from users. We also want to leverage existing accounts at the city, so we are hoping that we have the support of counselors to help spread messages as well as through our departmental accounts. We may look to traditional communications, so we may look at, say, got our Twitter link in there. Maybe, you know, whenever there's an opportunity, we will find, we will use that opportunity basically to promote. We'll obviously add the Twitter link to the city website. We'll work through Jay's team to kind of figure out how to best do that. And again, employee awareness. So as part of the promotion, again, we want to make sure that staff are aware of what we're doing and what we're trying to achieve. As far as evaluation, so I'm almost done. So evaluation, we're going to do sort of a one-year review in 2014. Some of the measures of effectiveness that we'll look at are some sort of the number of retweets, number of followers. But what I think is most important is the quality of the conversation. It's really looking at the sentiment, the tone, how are residents responding to us. I think that's a lot more important than just the number of followers. I think that that's important to point out. Clicks on links. So if we ever post a link to something, maybe there's a way that we can measure that behind the scenes to see if that was directed from Twitter, so we can sort of test the effectiveness of that. And as part of our evaluation, I think we also want to look at, so we use these internal resources, how well is it working? Do we need to make some adjustments? Do we need to sort of tweak things as we go? So that's really an overview of our strategy. And what I wanted to kind of leave things off with was, actually this is an article that Mike sent me last week, and I thought that there was some really, just a couple lines I want to read, which is that social media has become such a part of so many of our lives that we often forget what made it so special in the first place. It wasn't the power to market to the masses, nor was it the opportunity for people to sort of market themselves as experts in a particular field. Social media was and is at its core a vehicle for human connection. And I think that the events of last week and what happened in Boston, it sort of demonstrates the ways in which this connection can manifest itself. So we saw connections between, you know, Boston police and the city. They made connections with citizens to get out crucial, possibly life-saving information. We saw connections perform between Bostonians. You know, they created this Boston Strong hashtag, which sort of rallied them all together. And there was just a huge outpouring of support from the public and from people around the world. So I think there's many examples, and not just during a tragedy, of how social media can sort of bring people together. And you know, people who share an interest in what is happening around the world, and also what's happening outside of the world, which kind of takes us to this image, which is Commander Chris Hadfield. He's up in space right now, and this is a great shot that he took in early January of the Golden Horseshoe. So I just want to kind of leave you with that, and I think that the key line here is that conversations are going to happen in the city with or without us, so why not be a part of that conversation? And I think that now is a great time for us to start reaching out to citizens. So that's really all I had to cover for today.
Councillor Partridge.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chair. Through you, we talk about doing an evaluation after 1 year, but looking at how information, everything happens so fast, 1 year seems like an awfully long time. I mean, we could Twitter could go through 3 more iterations between now and then. There could be something completely different that comes on the scene. And I look at a 1 year, and I think, so that's kind of typical language that we put into the way we do things in the city. But I want to challenge those norms, and I think if we're going to do this, we need to really start challenging how we do business, how we communicate with our community, and how we evaluate. 1 year is a dinosaur time. So I don't know what your thoughts are on that, but Mike, you want to comment?
I think Mike can provide us with resources, and you'll get it sooner.
You're absolutely right. I mean, I think you're right. You know, I think it's typical. We look at things in a yearly basis and we say we're going to evaluate and make sure the resource seems right. But I think we're constantly going to be monitoring this. We realize how important this discussion is and how important it is for us to get out on social media and how quickly things can change, both good and bad. Mm-hmm. So we're going to constantly, I mean, this isn't something that we're going to go into and not be aware of some of the potential challenges and opportunities. But we're constantly going to be monitoring it, constantly going to be assessing it at the beginning, and we do anticipate at the beginning it's going to take some additional time for all of us, and it should be, you know, kind of all hands on deck as we kind of, you know, migrate to this system and to using social media. We probably should have more time that we're committing to it, and then it'll be a constant, I think, you know, kind of iterative process as we go through this. We're definitely going to be monitoring it. So on a yearly basis, we may be reporting back, if not sooner. But in terms of, you know, the consistent monitoring of it, and you know, Jay and I quickly chatted about that, it has to be something that's kind of ongoing, and we'll have to look at a number of different analytics and a number of the channels and see where things are being directed from and into. So absolutely.
Item 4.3 on our agenda is the updates, and this covered off the three areas speaking of
so that could
the web redevelopment. So maybe we should look at just adding that as a standing agenda item, and if there's updates, you've got the opportunity. Failing that, we just put in no report, whatever, but we would certainly, I think all of us would welcome you back anytime for either verbal updates. I mean, it's not necessary to provide us with a written report. Come back to us with verbals if there's something new and exciting or something that you need us to provide some direction and assistance on. But
absolutely, because I trust you launch it, you will probably want to know how we're doing in the first couple of weeks.
So, sure.
Well, you'll see how we're doing, but
yeah,
you probably want a presentation or a conversation. Absolutely. Absolutely.
Oh, good suggestion,
right,
Chair.
Right.
Thank you.
Anything further, anyone? Ann?
And to the Chair, I don't think it's going to take us years to really be able to assess how well we're doing. We're going to know right off the bat. We're going to be engaging with citizens. They're going to tell us. They're going to be honest. I mean, that's just how they are. They'll be very blunt, very direct, and we'll know if we need to adjust course and make some adjustments, but I just wanted to make that clear, yeah.
One last comment, thank you, Chair. One last comment on that. Don't let the few drive the city. A very wise politician once said to me, listen to the silent majority. And I think that's what this is about. It's for the broader community. It's not just to engage a handful of people who could take the conversation in a whole different direction. We need to control this.
We've already learned this once.
Thank you.
Anne, thank you very much for the presentation.
Thank you so
and to all of you on the communications team, thank you very much for not only your attendance, but your participation. And all of you involved in the various aspects, whether it's, you know, it's Jane or Jennifer or Beth or everyone associated with this, we appreciate that. Could I have a motion to receive the presentations under 4.3? Pearson and Collins on the motion.
Carried.
Also favored. Carried. Any further discussion items? Councillor Collins?
Mr. Chairman, yesterday at Public Works, we had a good discussion about posting maintenance activities on the city's website. And I was poised to make a motion there at Public Works, but this may involve other departments and certainly is relevant to the discussions we're having about our own website. And so I would ask that we ask staff to investigate the feasibility of posting information related to, at a minimum at this point in time, our sewer and water, stormwater maintenance activities on the city's website. And that essentially, the discussion revolved around the fact that we're out there, we're video cameraing some of these locations, we're cleaning catch basins, and immediately when a storm comes through, first question from a resident is, when was the last time you were on my street?
Right.
We haven't seen you for X amount of time. And so this was about being proactive in terms of trying to assure the public that infrastructure and maintenance are priorities for us. And I think Jerry Davis noted that they certainly have that information. It's readily available. So the question is now, how do we incorporate that in a meaningful way on the city's website? And so I put that motion here today and asked that staff come back at the appropriate time. There's certainly no sense of urgency, but I think it is something that would help us going through, again, or into that rainy season, if you want to call it that, over the next couple of months. So
I
put that on the motion.
Councillor Partridge,
thank you.
Discussion?
Just excellent. I'm really pleased. And I noticed when you had the Calgary site up, it had the street sweeping mapping. So with that also, I think it would be great that we can have a consistent, going forward, let's do it right the first time, have a consistent mapping that we could do overlays on eventually that would assist in getting different information out, correct?
Yeah.
Perfect. Excellent.
Well, I can tell you the street sweep went by my place at 4:09 a.m.
Uh-oh. And you got calls at 4:10.
And it did a wonderful job. Okay, so on the motion, all those in favor?
Carry.
Which is a segue into at the March 27th Public Works Committee, there was a motion to approve that staff be directed to provide progress updates to the Web Redevelopment Subcommittee respecting their investigation into the feasibility of a plow tracking program. So could I have a motion to add this to our OBL? And it will come back to this committee. So, Councillor Pearson, Councillor Collins, on the motion, all those in favor?
Carried.
Any further items, general information, or add-ons? Anyone? Beth?
I just wanted to mention
with respect to these motions, we will consider those, and I'm glad that you mentioned the words not urgent, that we're very mindful of, there's a wealth of information out there that would be helpful to the community, and we have a lot of baggage that we need to shed from the old website, so that's really an important thing that staff are focusing on right now, is that reviewing outdated and redundant information so that we can start fresh and understand these needs. So it's great to put the information on the table now so we know what kind of technology platform that we need to build it to, and those things can be readily added as we move forward. That it's exciting, so much potential, so we have to get rid of the old stuff first so we can get ahead of that.
But as Councillor Collins' definition of not urgent is not this week.
I'm just trying to manage expectations.
Just do it right.
Anything further, anyone? We, I believe we stand, was it May the 29th, I think? So, a motion to stand adjourned until May 29th. Pearson Partridge on the motion. Harry, thank you.